can't believe it's really here. Our team has been planning this since August, and we're thrilled to see such a wonderful audience of cyber practitioners, cyber scholars, people in the business, Israelis, Americans, all of us. I have to say that it was very hard for me to wrap my arms around this subject. This is the third conference that we've done in partnership with American Associates of Ben-Gurion University of the Negev, bringing some of the foremost scholars in the world to American University, to many of whom have collaborated with our own faculty, to look at issues that are of concern to all of us in the world. And cyber seemed so abstract. I would say that after spending a few hours with our speakers tonight, I think we should all be very scared. this is like a whole world I still don't know about, but I now really want to learn a lot. And thrilled that we have such wonderful experts to inform us about a universe that's happening all around us. I just want to let our speakers know who's here. So if you are an AU faculty member, could you raise your hand? And where's Yuval and Amir? So they're seeing who's here. If you're a student at our university, great. And if you are a affiliate of Ben-Gurion in some way, and if you exist in the cyber world professionally, just all of us apparently do, but okay, great. So that gives us a little bit of an idea. So it's really a thrill tonight to introduce our speaker, Yuval Elovich, which is the proper pronunciation of his name. And he's the only one with that name in the internet. With that last name in the internet. I think he exemplifies what makes Israeli innovation so special, and in particular, what happens at Ben-Gurion University, because he is involved in a very special public-private academic partnership. He's not only head of Deutsche Telekom Laboratory, but he's a professor at Ben-Gurion in information systems engineering. So it provides the opportunity for students to work on real-life problems with a company that is also benefiting from the students' expertise. And this wonderful kind of symbiotic relationship that has been created there and really could be a model for us. And it also provides a pipeline of people at Ben-Gurion that have real-life problem-solving skills. So really, just like the pioneers who came to Israel and made the desert bloom, there are now pioneers in the Negev that are creating a community of people that are active in the cyber arena. The government is involved, in private industry is involved, and this is an academic partnership with Ben-Gurion to form this CyberSpark ecosystem with community members like Elbit and IBM. So it's created quite a lot of buzz. And I only discovered a couple weeks ago that Yuval is actually working on a series of papers with one of our own professors, Natalie Japkovich, who may be here. Yes, she is. Hello, Natalie. They are publishing in the IEEE Intelligent Systems Journal, so thank you for your work together, and I'm glad that it exemplifies how our universities really have researchers working together. After Yuval speaks, we are very honored to have a top Israeli journalist with us, Amir Rapoport, who's the founder of Israel Defense Magazine, which is a leading commentator on defense and homeland security developments in Israel. But as if that wasn't enough of a job for him, he created this thing called Israel Cyber Tech, which is a huge conference put on attracting people from the whole world in cyber, and it's like become a phenomenon that's now taking place all over the world. So many of you may have heard of CyberTech, and he has agreed to moderate questions from you after the presentation. So with no further ado, I will introduce Yuval, and feel free to tweet. And
okay. Very happy to describe to you a part of our research in BGU. I'm going to talk today about the security of Internet of Things. What are the challenges? Why it's so important to study this topic? I will start by explaining, first of all, the domain. Later on, I'm going to conclude with several very, a little bit more technical examples of research results that we managed to accomplish in this domain. So what will my presentation will include? First of all, I want us to agree about what it is, Internet of Things, IoT. Then I'm going to describe to you several of the security challenges by giving you several examples of how people actually manage to compromise IoTs in order to accomplish something for themselves, how attackers actually manage to do that. I am going to describe to you, in a nutshell, several research directions that we are currently exploring in order to try to somehow mitigate some of the attacks that people may do against Internet of Things. And I'm going to give you in detail two examples. I'm going to conclude with one of our latest media exposure about a very, very advanced cyber attack that can be launched using something that we called bridging the air gap, that could be done also via IoT or without an IoT. First of all, about the definition of IoT, Internet of Things. Actually, an IoT, it's any device that is not a computer and not a mobile phone that somehow is connected to the network. You know, before the revolution of the internet, we had private networks connecting different computers. With the internet, computers managed to be connected to each other via the internet. The revolution of the Internet of Things is taking very, very small devices and connecting them to the internet. It could be our smart home system. It could be an industrial environment where the connection is to the internet. And it could be also, for example, a medical device that is connected in the hospital to the network of the hospital. Just to give you an extreme example, Da Vinci. Da Vinci, it's a platform that allows the doctor to operate in a robotic manner. So actually, he has joysticks, and you can make an operation to a patient. But actually, Da Vinci allows to conduct the operation from remote. So the doctor can sit 50 kilometers from the location of the patients and conduct an operation. In the Da Vinci, from our perspective, it's an IoT, because this device is connected to the network and is being controlled remotely by the user. It is expected that the number of IoTs is going to be huge in the future. I think in 2020, it's expected that for every person in the world, there's going to be at least 7 IoTs connected to the network. And it's expected that the IoTs are going to communicate a lot between themselves and less with us as human beings. So some of the IoTs are connected to the network wirelessly, and some are connected via a wire. For example, we can have a camera, a wireless camera at home, connected via the wireless, and we could have at home a camera, a security camera, connected via the wire. Some of them, of the IoTs, like for example a smart meter, is connected directly to the cloud, to the internet. And some of the IoTs, like for example my smartwatch is not connected directly to the internet. It is connected to my mobile phone, and from my mobile phone, it is connected actually to the internet. Now, what are the security challenges that relates to IoT? Let me try to describe to them, and each one of them using an example. First of all, the issue of privacy. Once somebody managed to compromise my IoT, he may access to any information that my smartwatch, for example, is accessible. My smartwatch, for example, has a heart rate meter. It may have a microphone. By compromising my smartwatch, somebody may use it to tap into what is happening around me by compromising it. Of course, for example, if somebody, we are trying to explore this issue, which is, by the way, very, very difficult, to see if an attacker can attack a smartwatch, using the smartwatch to try to understand what is my pulse and what is the advantage. For example, in case of a poker game, I want to know what is the quality of the cards of my opponents. I just need to hack his smartwatch and I will know if he's bluffing or not. This is one example. It relates to privacy. Integrity. Attackers may try to attack an IoT in order to influence the physical world. For example, we have demos in BGU where I can, via the cyber, disable smart camera. But not only to disable the smart camera, the IP cameras, we managed to freeze a camera. And we have a very, very nice demo where we have a camera pointed to a jewelry. We are freezing the camera, and then we can actually steal the jewelry. This is an attack that has an impact on the physical world. Authorization. Today, IoTs are belonging to someone that installed them. But many attackers are trying to compromise IoT devices in order to make use of them as part of a botnet. A botnet is a collection of compromised devices that can launch an attack against a third party. In the past, most of the botnets were built from personal computers. Today, it's much easier to compromise IoT devices. Think about smart cameras. They are connected to the internet, very, very large bandwidth. If I manage to compromise many IP cameras, I am creating an army of compromised computers that I can use them to attack a third party. One of the unique security challenges that relates to IoT is, first of all, to detect the existence of IoT, especially in an office environment. Since IoTs, once they are compromised, can give an advantage to the attacker, first of all, organization needs to understand which IoTs exist around them. You know, now companies are renting an office space. There is, in the infrastructure of the office space, many, many IoTs embedded in the walls. First of all, we need to identify all of them to know from what to protect ourselves. Wearable devices. I gave you the example. Wearable devices can be used to create a cyber attack inside the organization. I need to verify that nobody has actually managed to compromise the smartwatch in order to launch a smart attack, a very sophisticated attack inside the organization. I will give you later on several examples about that. But the biggest challenge, from my perspective, that relates to IoT is what I called unmaintained IoT devices. Opposed to the PC world or opposed to the mobile phone world, usually when somebody is manufacturing an IoT, the manufacturer, when he's manufacturing an IoT, after selling the product, he doesn't have the time or the money to continue and upgrade and patch the product against possible vulnerabilities that were discovered. We expect, for example, Microsoft to update Windows in case that there is a new vulnerability being identified. In the domain of IoT, this is not the case. If a manufacturer is selling, for example, an IP camera, he's focusing on the next generation of IP cameras, and he's not going to try and to patch all the existing devices that are in the market. So eventually what is going to happen in the future, actually it's already happening today, that we have billions of devices that can be compromised and they are being connected to the internet. I will give you later on an example about a smart fridge. These devices are actually developed when they were launched. Maybe they didn't have any vulnerability. Over time, people identified new vulnerabilities. You know, attackers are very, very smart. They are sharing information via the dark market, dark web, about the existence of vulnerabilities. And then we are going to have billions of devices that everybody literally can compromise them and use them for their own purposes. That's the biggest challenge in IoT security. To give you several examples about privacy violation. By the way, we read in the latest reports that even the CIA used to compromise smart TVs to use their microphone to listen to what is happening in the living room. That's one example. Another example is integrity of IoT devices is to compromise, for example, traffic lights that are connected to the internet, and by compromising them, we can influence the traffic in the city. Another example is smart refrigerators were compromised in order to send spam from the refrigerators. Now, from the point of view of the owner, he doesn't care. As long as the fridge is working, what do I care if somebody is compromising it and sending spam from my fridge? From the point of view of the rest of the world, it's a huge problem. But I'm going to come back to the smart fridge because I have another use case, very interesting one. This is the use case. Just to give you an example, we bought a fridge from Samsung, a smart fridge. Now, in Israel, because it's a smart fridge, it cost us $4,000. And I bought it from a cyber bureau budget, so it's okay. And the only thing that makes the fridge smart, it's a small display on the fridge. It actually is based on an operating system that is being manufactured by Samsung, connected to the internet. Now, how it is connected? Wirelessly. Now, we discovered that there is a very, very severe vulnerability that exists to this specific fridge. Actually, the vulnerability is not of the fridge. The vulnerability is of the operating system being used to make this fridge smarter. Samsung decided not to upgrade this fridge to the next generation of operating system. In other words, there is a fridge with vulnerability, and this fridge is going to be in the university for another 20 years, vulnerable to cyber attacks. For example, what is the most obvious cyber attack, in my opinion, against a fridge? Is to create a ransomware. Friends, first of all, the fridge can communicate with its user because it has a screen. So me, as an attacker, what I'm going to do, I'm going to write a malware that is going to write to the user, look, you have to pay me 2 bitcoins, otherwise I'm going to increase the temperature by 1 degree every hour. It's a ransomware. And how can you fix it? And it's only because this device is actually vulnerable. And we are going to see more and more ransomware against IoTs in the future. By the way, I'm expecting to see also ransomware against smart cars. Imagine yourself, you come in the morning, enter to your car, in the infotainment, pay me 2 bitcoin, otherwise you cannot start the car. We are going to see it more and more, and it's only because these devices are connected to the internet, accessible to cyber attackers. We talked about botnet. You know, what is the motivation of attacking IoTs? IoTs are connected to the internet, not protected, not patched. It's the easiest ways to create many, many compromised devices and via them to launch what we call denial of service attacks against a third party. That's one of the biggest challenges, and it's very, very difficult to stop such attacks. And the biggest problem that in many, many cases, the victim, the owner of the IoT, is not affected by the attack. A third party is affected by the fact that somebody managed to compromise many devices and launch an attack against a third party. How can we cope with that? Now, we discovered that there is not a silver bullet solution that can address all the challenges that I just described to you. And there is a need to develop many, many mechanisms, each one addressing a different aspect of the problem. So let me give you several examples of what we are doing in BGU. And later on, I will try to go a little bit deeper, a little bit more technical, to give you an example of what we managed to accomplish via our research. First of all, we discovered that in many cases, we are buying add-ons, aftermarket accessories, and connect them to devices. It could be an aftermarket accessory that is connected to, for example, our mobile phone. It could be a battery. It could be something that we are buying. And there is a risk that actually somebody managed to compromise this device, and this device eventually is going to impact our own IoT. I don't know if you heard about it. Some people sold IP cameras in eBay with a lower price, but actually they bought regular IP cameras, embedded a different firmware or embedded a malware inside these cameras, and then sold them to people, compromised. It's like compromised by design. This is a huge problem. The question is how to address it, and we are trying to develop technologies to defend against that. Another issue is to detect the fact that there is an IoT that is being used inside the organization to launch cyber attacks against the organization. For example, it could be that we have, for example, this system. We have here a small computer connected to this projector. This is a computer. Now, do you think somebody is patching this computer? Nobody is patching it. So if I am a cyber attacker and I'm doing a lot of expertise in cyber attacks, I will not attack a PC. I will not attack a server that everybody is monitoring it. I will attack this system. And this system, once I'm going to manage to compromise it via this system, I'm going to do all the malicious actions inside the organization. The question is, how can we detect that an IoT is compromised? In order to do that, first of all, we need to learn automatically what is the normal behavior of the device, and then to try to see that the device is starting to behave in an abnormal manner. For example, we may have in the organization a smart IoT smoke detector. It's perfect, you know, it's IoT smoke detector connected to the infrastructure of the organization. It will tell us when there is smoke in the area. The problem is that once it's an IoT, I, as an attacker, I'm going to attack this smoke detector because nobody is going to patch it. Nobody is going to look for me there, and it's going to allow me to create persistency inside the organization. In order to be able to detect that, I need to learn what is the normal behavior of a smoke detector, and once it deviates from the normal behavior, I will know that actually it is being compromised. Authentication of IoT devices. That's a huge challenge. And I will give you a very, very small example. Let's assume that I designed a sensor. It is placed on the road. The goal of this sensor is to count the number of cars that are passing in the road. Now, I managed to develop a very sophisticated technology to authenticate this IoT device in front of the backend system that, based on that, may change the traffic lights because it is counting the number of cars. Let us assume that I did it in a perfect way, encryption, perfect authentication, even the box is completely sealed, you cannot open it. What an attacker may do, he may take the sensor from one road and place it in another road. So everything is authenticated, but the information that I receive from the sensor is false. It's counting the number of cars in a different road. How can we do that? How can we guarantee that whatever the IoT is giving us is genuine and relates to what is really happening around the IoT device? That's a very, very big challenge. We're trying to work also on this domain. IoT privacy. That's a very, very, very big problem. Because today, IoT devices are collecting a lot of information about ourselves. And one of the challenges is to try to estimate the level of potential privacy damage that may be caused to us by an IoT. Give you an example. In the smart fridge of Samsung that we investigated, we managed eventually to hack and to intercept all the traffic between the smart fridge and Samsung backend system. And we discovered that this fridge is sending to Samsung an indication each time that we are opening the fridge. So literally, Samsung knows when somebody is in the house. Did I know about it? Before we managed to hack it, we didn't know that actually it's sending this information. So the question is how to estimate the level of privacy. There was a very, very funny story that relates to that in the news. I don't know if you heard about it. Maybe you did. About a smart vibrator. I don't know if you heard about it. Very famous story. That somebody in Canada created a lawsuit against the manufacturer because it was discovered that this smart vibrator is communicating to the mobile phone, and via the mobile phone, the manufacturer sent information about when it was used, intensity, temperature, humidity, everything. They claim, by the way, that they need this information to improve the product. Who cares? And by the way, when you install the app, you are being told that they are collecting this information, but who is reading? Yes, yes, yes. And eventually, there was a lawsuit. They have to pay $3.5 million. But in this case, somebody was attentive enough to check what the IoT is collecting about the user. But there are many, many cases where you don't know about it. Just to give another example, my smartwatch knows exactly what is my resting pulse. Now, my resting pulse is a very, very good indicator of my well-being. Now, if I want, for example, to sell information to insurance company, to medical insurance companies, I will hack the manufacturer of this Garmin. I will obtain information about millions of people, what is their resting pulse, and I'm going to sell this information to insurance companies. Are people aware about the fact, what is the implication of having such a smartwatch? We need somehow to teach people about what is the implication and somehow to be able to model the level of privacy that every IoT may cause to us. Another issue, a little bit more complicated, is IoT that are involved in advanced cyber attacks. Look, today, if I want to create a persistency, to have a persistency inside the organization, I will try to hide inside IoT devices. What we are trying to investigate is what is the impact on the security of an organization once somebody is installing another IoT inside the organization, because every device that you install inside the organization creates additional attack paths. So what we try to do is to learn to estimate them, to analyze them, and to warn the organization about the risk from a new IoT installed inside the organization. So one of the techniques to mitigate such attacks is to build a very, very advanced security assessment testbed. I'm going to describe to you what we did in a few minutes. The goal was to try to create an environment where we can bring an IoT and we are going to analyze the IoT against a plethora of risks, privacy, security, and to create some kind of an estimate what is the level of security of this specific IoT. Let me give you an example about the IoT security testbed. That's a research that we are developing together with a university in Singapore. What actually we did, we built a shielded room. A shielded room is a room that we control all the electromagnetic emissions inside the room, and we can fool the device to think that it's in a totally different location. In a few minutes, you will understand why it is so important for us. And the idea was to develop an environment where we actually can control everything inside the room and mimic for the IoT device a specific location. Why it's important to mimic for the device a location? Because it is possible that an IoT device will behave in a malicious manner only in a specific location. and we will behave in a naive way in a different location. We try to create an environment where we can mimic and fool the IoT to think that it's in a specific location. Let me show you, this is how the room looks like. And then to demonstrate the potential impact of such an IoT testbed, we developed two malware. Now, this is the environment that we developed inside the testbed. You see two smart watches. We have here a GPS generator. The GPS generators can generate a GPS signals to fool the device to think that it's in a specific location. Then we have a Wi-Fi network that can fool the IoT device to think that, for example, is inside this university. And we have the testbed environment, and you see here also a wireless printer. So what we did, we wrote two malware. The first malware, it's a malware that is running on the Sony smartwatch, but the malware is opening a Wi-Fi connection on the smartwatch and start to learn about the environment of the organization. It's running an Nmap. Nmap is a very famous tool that can learn about the infrastructure of the organization. But since when you are opening a Wi-Fi connection on the smartwatch, you are consuming a lot of battery, this attack is not feasible. To make it feasible, we use the GPS and we activate the attack only when the watch is in a specific environment. So when you are wearing this watch, compromised watch, nothing happens. But when the watch enters into the organization that I want to attack, suddenly the malicious app activates and then it starts to scan the organization. The second malicious application was even more sophisticated. The second application did the following. Listen very, very carefully. Once you reach the organization, the smartwatch mimicked a Wi-Fi printer. You see, in the organization, there is a Wi-Fi printer. We managed to turn a smartwatch into a Wi-Fi printer only when the watch is inside the organization. In other words, what happened? Somebody came to the organization, sat on his table, and he wanted to print a document. He printed a document to his wireless printer, but the document went to the watch, not to the printer. From the watch, it was leaked to the internet, and from the watch, it went also to the real printer. So in this case, we used the smartwatch to steal documents from the organization. To do that, again, the watch had to know that it reached the location of the organization. How did it? Via the Wi-Fi network and the GPS. So what actually we did in this setup, we fooled the watch using the GPS and using the Wi-Fi network here to think that he actually reached the location of the organization. And then we measured the behavior of the watch. If the watch in a specific location behaves totally different, what is the implication? That somebody actually put a very smart malware inside that only in a specific location it behaves differently. So in the testbed, this is a setup, by the way, you can see all the setup, including the GPS generator, including Google Maps, that you can see that will mimic any location for the smartwatch. So the smartwatch is thinking that I'm getting into the organization. So we measured, for example, the CPU utilization. We measured the memory consumption. We measured the communication behavior. And we saw that only in a specific location, when we told the watch that it is in a specific location, only then all the anomalies appeared, which indicates that actually it is a compromised device that launched a cyber attack only in a specific location. Of course, the tricky part is to know what is the triggering mechanism. In this case, we assume that the triggering mechanism is location. The problem is for any organization to understand what is the triggering mechanism. On the other hand, if I'm mimicking to a device my location and nothing happens, I don't care. Maybe it's all going to attack only another organization. But this is an example of how, using the testbed, we managed to identify that a specific smartwatch is compromised. The second research that I wanted to describe to you, it's about IoT intrusion detection. Here, we realized that the biggest challenge of many organizations is, first of all, to identify all the IoT devices, and secondly, to identify that actually they are being compromised. So we decided to focus, first of all, on the first part. Let's try to identify automatically inside the organization all the IoT devices. So how we did that? We decided to do it by monitoring all the network traffic inside the organization. You know, because you know, IoT device is communicating. So the communication of the IoT device must be visible on the communication network of the organization. So what we did, we tapped to all the communication inside the organization, and we tried to train a model using machine learning techniques to identify every type of IoT device. So we took many, many types of IoT devices, and you believe me, every IoT device generates a different type of traffic on the network of the organization. You see, even this smart switch generates a traffic, and of course, the traffic that it generates is totally different than the traffic, for example, that Google Glass generates. Now, why it's important? Because it may happen that an organization does not allow anybody to bring a Google Glass inside the organization. Or somebody managed to sneak Google Glass into the organization. I want to be able, by tapping to the network, to identify that somebody brought Google Glass against the company policy. That's my goal. So in this case, we monitored the network traffic. We extracted a lot of features from the network traffic. We trained a model. We collected, first of all, a huge amount of data. And then we wanted to see whether we can identify all the IoT devices inside the organization. First of all, we discovered that in any organizations, there are IoTs, there are mobile phones, and there are PCs. And we managed to find that it's relatively easy to identify all the mobile phones, because in a mobile phone, when you are navigating, there is a property called user agent that gives the exact model of the mobile phone. So detecting mobile phone, it's very, very easy. Then we managed to train very easily a model to differentiate between a PC and something else. What is the something else? IoT. So eventually, we clean all the mobile phones, all the PCs, and now we are left only with IoTs communicating on the network. So what we did next, we trained a model to detect each type of IoT device. For example, I have a model to detect a smart fridge. I have a model to detect Google Glass. So we trained many, many models. The problem is that some of the IoT devices are not behaving the same all the time, and our model may not be accurate enough. So what we did, we learned how many sessions we need to classify in order to be sure that it's the specific device. For example, in this case, you see, I want to detect whether there is a smart camera inside the organization. What we discovered here, that if we are analyzing 3 sessions, and the classifier tells us that 3 sessions, 2 out of them, it's a smart camera, for sure it's a smart camera. So using this technology, we can detect all the IoT devices inside the organization automatically. And if, for example, we know to detect, let's say, Google Glass, it's not allowed, we are going to detect it immediately and alert the chief security officer about its existence. In addition, we trained another model to identify or to learn about a specific IoT devices. For example, in this case, we allow security camera, we allow motion sensor, refrigerator, socket, thermostat, TV, smartwatch, but we don't allow to bring to the organization, we have a very strange policy, baby monitor. Okay? So, what will happen using this model is we are going to detect it very easily because it's not one of the devices that are allowed to be brought to this organization. This is an example, and the final result is that by analyzing 250 sessions of every device, we can very, very accurately identify what is the type of device inside the organization. That concludes my description of two examples. And I want to conclude with two or several additional research challenges. First of all, I told you before, one of the biggest challenges is unmaintained IoT devices. Remember that? You're going to have billions of unmaintained devices that nobody would like to patch them. Then comes the question, how can we live with devices that are not being patched? For example, the smart fridge in my lab. How can we live with this smart fridge even though that Samsung is not willing to patch it? So what we are trying to do is developing technologies to prevent the attackers from attacking the smart fridge on the known vulnerabilities without the involvement of the device manufacturer. Another challenge is how to monitor IoT devices in a trusted manner. And the third one, which I gave you a very, very nice, sexy example, is how to estimate the privacy of every IoT device. To conclude, I want to expose you to another research that we did in BGU. It is about bridging the air gap. In this example, it was not done by an IoT, but in the future, such attacks will be done by an IoT because many IoT devices possess an LED. And if I have an IoT, for example, a smoke detector, it has an LED, I can use this LED to leak information out of the organization. How can I do that? So I'm going to give you a little bit different example. Assume that I have in the organization a PC. In the PC, usually there is a hard drive. And the hard drive usually has an LED. Believe me, I don't remember even when people started to put LEDs to indicate that there is an activity with the hard drive. Today, it's ridiculous to do it. But it's still existing in any PC. In any PC, you have an LED that indicates if the computer is reading something from the hard drive. So how can attacker can use the fact that there is an LED for his own benefit? We managed to write a malware that accessed the hard drive in order to activate the LED and to leak information from the organization. In other words, by accessing to the LED, the hard drive LED can blink 4,000 times a second. We actually leaked information from the organization. But how can I take the information, the LED light, from the organization? We took the information from the LED using the following manner. By the way, we called this attack "Let It Go." Look how we are stealing information from the organization. This is, by the way, our own building. It's a very, very advanced drone, Inspire 1 Pro. You will see here, in a few seconds, here there is a computer. You see the LED blinking? We identified the computer, and now we start to take information from the organization using the drone. In this case, it was from a PC, the same attack I could do by leaking information from an IoT. It has a small LED. I can compromise it, and using that, I can exfiltrate data out of the organization. I'll give you an example how IoTs can be combined to leak information from the organization. In this case, we did it with a regular PC with its LED. Try to think and to imagine how many IoT devices today possess an LED. Once it is compromised, I can leak the information out of the organization. You see here the LED blinking, sending all the information out of the organization. Sorry? Oh, you see? Everything started. Look, I in general claim that the main motivation behind cyber attacks is money. In poker, there is money. There are going to be efforts. That concludes what I wanted to tell you about IoT, and I will be very, very happy to answer any of your questions.
So, Yuval, before going to the audience, I would like to clarify one thing with you, okay? Because I see many, many students that's following your scaring presentations around the world and like to be rich and to be cyber experts. And I would like to clarify that we are not talking about a bubble. How could you explain or tell us that it's not a bubble?
Look, I think that the best example to give you that it's not a bubble is that we actually created a spin-off out of our my lab called Morphisec, that its goal is to try to defend against very advanced attacks.
It's a startup.
Startup against APTs. I will describe a little bit more about the Morphisec tomorrow, but in general, I thought, you know, we are going to install in an organization anti-APT technology, and we are going to get once a month, you know, somebody is going to tell us, look, there was an attack. And we are very, very concerned that the companies that are going to installing our technology will not see that we are doing anything, because you know, only once in a month there is going to be an attack. And we are really astonished by the number of attacks that are being done against our customers. It really surprised me, because I thought that an advanced attack is something very, very rare. But I'm telling you, it's not. It's astonishing how many attacks are being launched against companies. I start even to think that people are doing it for, many attackers are doing it for fun, and once they're going to get there, they are selling the capabilities to a third party. But there are many, many cyber attacks, and the potential is huge. And as I said before to one of the people that gave a comment, it's all about money. Follow the latest publication about Morphisec about an attack against 180 financial institutions. Where is the money? The attackers are being dragged to there. And the motivation of attacker is huge.
Okay, so quite convinced. And I don't like to make a spoiler toward the very, very interesting conference tomorrow, but I'm not sure that you are not going to, that you are going to talk about it. So I ask you now, because you are talking IoT, IoT, IoT. So this is the buzzword, and much more than a buzzword. But I would like to ask you if the next buzzword, let's say in 5 years from now, going to be the AI, the artificial intelligence? And could you explain to the audience, please?
Look, today, one of the biggest trends in the market today is developing systems that are based on AI. And the systems that are based on AI are being designed while thinking that the users are actually good users, that are not trying to compromise it. What I expected is going to happen in the future, that attackers will try to compromise systems that are based on AI for their own benefits. Just to give you a very, very small example, we identified a specific bug in Google Chrome. And we approached Google. We sent Google an email about this bug. And Google told us that it's they have a bug bounty, you know, program. You discover a bug, they give you money. So you talk about money, you wanted to make money. Okay. So we sent them an email. So they answer us, no, you don't deserve to get via email. You don't deserve actually to get a price for it. Okay. So we sent another email. Can we publish it? Because it was related to a DRM. DRM is something very, very severe. Maybe the lawyers here know about it, but in the US, you are not allowed to publish a vulnerability that relates to DRM, digital right management. Actually, it's allowed us, the attack allowed us to record every movie that you see on Netflix. We could actually record it on the PC and distribute it. So it has very, very severe bug. So we asked them, can we publish it about the fact that we discovered this bug via email? And they answer us, yes, you can do it, no problem. So we approached Wired magazine. We told them, look, there is a very, very severe bug in Google Chrome. So of course, the journalist approached Google to ask them, look, what do you think about it? Google was in hysteria. We never got such a request before, so she showed them the emails. You know what we discovered? That actually, all our communication was with a chatbot. It's an AI system. Now think about it. It's an AI system. Now, I can imagine myself, if I want to publish something against Google as an attacker, I will find a way how to ask Google the question in the way that the answer is going to be yes. Maybe because we are Israelis, we didn't know how to write the email, so they didn't understand what we actually discovered. But I can do it on purpose. I can write an email to fool the AI system on the other side for my own benefit. And such attacks are going to be more and more in the future when systems are going to be AI systems. And the methodology of how to defend them is going to be completely new.
Okay, last point to clarify with you before applying to the audience is less about cyber technology, but more about marketing. And I would like to ask you, maybe as a native Be'er Sheva guy myself and the alumni of the BGU, how this desert city became so famous in the world, especially BGU, of course, for cyber security. It's like a miracle.
It's really like a miracle. It happened by coincidence because we were very lucky 13 years ago that Deutsche Telekom opened a center in our university. It started by cybersecurity. By the way, the term was not even coined back then. And since then, Deutsche Telekom invested tens of millions of dollars in BGU, half of it devoted to cybersecurity. And this is actually what built the competence, at least in the university, in the domain of cybersecurity. Later on, many other companies are funding us, EMC, Lockheed Martin, and many other big companies. And of course, the Ministry of Defense is funding us for the last 10 years, and of course, the Cyber Bureau. So we developed a very, very strong competence in the domain of cybersecurity. also by coincidence, the government decided to move all the IT units that relates to cybersecurity to the Negev. They didn't move yet. It's a process. It will take over several years. But the students from these units already came to us. So we have amazing, amazing students. I'm telling you, all the innovations, everything that I'm showing to you is done by the students. They are the real brain behind all our innovations. So from one hand, you have the university, you have the army, you have the competence in BGU. So we feel that even when the hype will disappear, we are going to stay very, very strong in the domain of cybersecurity.
So actually this is, So actually this is more about the ecosystem, and now I would like to go to the ecosystem of the American University. And yeah, I collect a couple of questions, okay? So go on, yeah.
Good evening. Thank you very much for coming to my school. My name is Julian Kyle Lewis. I'm a candidate for the Master of Public Policy here. I concentrate in international education policy. And the gentleman mentioned how information is being shared via the dark web, and how, you know, these are very dangerous, very, very smart people. And what I've learned is that really, you mentioned how the students, you know, that you've leaned on their advice and how they've incrementally built up our understanding of these issues. And what I'm trying to do is get more students involved in math and science at an earlier age, so we have more of a pool of students to choose from who can specialize in these types of securities. Because what we come down to is brass tacks of, okay, we really can't figure this out. And we can't find anybody who can figure this out. But we look on the news and we say, okay, the Department of Education is about to be disbanded. We're losing funding to be able to provide an adequate math and science education to students so they can learn this stuff to help keep all of us safe, keep all of us alive. Can you speak to how we would be able to get more young kids involved in math and science to help organizations like your own and organizations around the world? Thank you very much.
First of all, you gave me a... reminded me a funny story, so I will start with it and then I will answer your question, if I will not forget. In our latest department meeting, some professor said, look, you can't imagine what happened. We should never send any more exams via the email. Somebody hacked into my email account, stole the exam, and they knew the exam. I came, I gave the exam, everybody knew about the questions. It's terrible. And she told us never use the email to send the exams. You know what was my answer? I told her she's totally wrong. You should create 5 exams, sending it between the professors. Let them work on the wrong exam. Let them prepare for the exam if we know that they are going to attacking anyhow. Because students are sharing information. So about your question, look, at least in Israel, what we are trying to do is, first of all, to increase the number of students that are studying math. There is a very big hysteria today in Israel to force, not to force, but to convince as many teenagers as possible to learn during the high school math. And by the way, even the worst problem is physics. People do not want to learn physics. I don't know how it is the US system, but in Israel, teenagers during high school, they can choose on what to specialize. Chemistry, biology, and so on. You know, today, the generation of today, I have many kids, they are extremely lazy. Very, very lazy. Why to go to math? We can learn less math and go to learn very simple things. So we definitely need to encourage people to learn more math. In Israel, in addition to that, we are trying to train people, teenagers, in the domain of cyber. The motivation is to increase the talent pool that eventually the army can choose from, that are experts in cybersecurity. And we are putting a lot of emphasis on this domain, not only because of the civilian sector, also from the military, because the military needs more and more talented people that can come from the high school and work in the domain of cybersecurity. Of course, after they finish the army in Israel for 4 or 5 years, they go to the market and they create a huge talent pool that can open startup companies and can join international companies that are opening branches in Israel, focusing on cybersecurity because of the manpower that we have in Israel.
So we take another student question first. Students? Lecturers? Okay, we have a question here.
Good evening. It's a fascinating topic. When I was a kid, I watched Star Wars, which exactly reminds me of what you talk about. I wonder who is going to control the space. And because we're coming to that point that whoever will control the space will control the internet. Now, the question is over here. Don't you think that people are asking for it to lose all the privacy? Because if you go on the internet and you fill up all the information about the bank account, obviously credit cards, everything is open. So if you ask the average over here, how many people do care about the privacy?
Look, I'm not a lawyer, but I learned from lawyers about the definition of privacy. The definition of privacy is that a person has control over information about himself. It's about the control. As long as I have control about the information about myself, if I want to expose myself in Facebook naked, it's my own business. I can do it. But I did it. I don't want that somebody that collected information about me will distribute information about me without my consent. And it's all about consent. The bigger issue is that even if I'm giving the consent, many people do not understand the implication of the consent because they don't understand enough. For example, in the case of my smartwatch, I don't know what will be the implication of the fact that I'm exposing so much information to Garmin. Garmin knows everything about me. They know where I'm running, how fast I'm running, if I'm lazy, not running enough, fast enough. They know everything about me. And still, I gave them this information, but I don't necessarily know the risk, what the potential implication will be if somebody will hack the website of Garmin and steal this information. So the issue of privacy is about the control. I want the people who will have the control. In the domain of IoT, the issue is to explain to the population what is the impact of privacy that relates to every IoT device. That's the main issue.
Good. So, yes. Yes, yes, you.
Oh. Yeah? Oh. Am I here? Someone else?
Okay, so we go this side and then to you.
Oh. Okay. Hi, thank you very much. Michael from College of Charleston. Two questions, actually. What's the general level of encryption with many of these IoT devices? And second, do you think consumers should demand having like a shut-off switch for a lot of these devices? For example, if the fridge is going haywire, they say, okay, I don't want internet access for this fridge. Let's just have the usual, like just have a regular fridge until the situation gets resolved. Thank you.
First of all, about the first question, usually cyber attackers like encryption because encryption allows to hide their own the activities of the attackers. You know, you see that encryption protects you from something. It doesn't protect you from anything because we are usually doing that cyber attacks below the encryption. So encryption doesn't necessarily help in the domain of IoT. One of the biggest challenges in the domain of IoT is managing the keys because there are billions of devices. How can we manage the keys? And here, there is a huge challenge. And there are many, many startup companies that try to develop an alternative mechanisms how to manage the keys for IoT devices. What was the second question? Shutdown, yes. We are currently trying to develop an innovative technology in BGU that doesn't relate even to the shutdown. It relates to having a secure channel to the IoT that will allow me to do whatever I want with the IoT remotely. And I totally agree with you that we need to have, it's not only, so I can also shut down the IoT from remote, but I want to have an access, even for example, to the memory of the IoT. So from remote, I will be able to acquire the memory and look if there is a malware inside the IoT. And we are working on this domain. And I know that other companies are working on this domain as well. It's part of the challenge that I wrote, which is about a trusted access, remote trusted access to the IoT, which is very, very important.
Good. Yes.
Would you recommend to public companies as well as private companies on as a member of their board to have a cybersecurity specialist on their board?
Very, very good question. I want to tell you something. Usually, I know the experiment of Deutsche Telekom, just to exemplify my my point. One of the biggest fears of the CEOs is from cybersecurity. Because, you know, think about the CEO of Target. He lost his position not because of bad financial figures of Target. He lost it because of cyber attack against Target. As a consequence of that, and also it was an incident inside Deutsche Telekom, that was a big breach of data being sold on eBay of 19 million customers of Deutsche Telekom. And then the chair of the CEO was shaken. So he placed in the board, in the executive board, you know, they have 7 people. One of the executive board members is somebody not responsible even of cybersecurity, on privacy, which is more severe in Germany. My concern about it is that actually the reason that the CEOs are putting these people in this position is not to make the company more secure, is to make the CEO position more secure. To have who to blame. So I'm not sure that this is the solution. I think it's important to have a CISO in a high position inside the organization, but it shouldn't remove the responsibility from the CEO to the security of the company. That's my opinion.
Yeah. By the way, this is the new regulation of the Israeli Cyber Bureau. Amir Becker over there could explain more about it tomorrow. He's the representative of the Israeli Cyber Bureau here in Washington, D.C. Laura, do we have time for last question?
Sure.
Okay.
From the Wharton Club of D.C., perhaps?
Yeah. No, I would like to take this question. Yeah, yeah.
You so all. We can take 2 questions.
Take two.
Okay.
Hi, thank you so much for your remarks. My name is Rebecca Lewis. I'm a faculty member here in the business school. My question is your discussion about detecting anomalous behavior by IoTs. And I was curious, given the number of IoT devices, do you think that it's feasible for either companies specifically or broader networks to actually collect all the data that would be needed to establish those baselines of normal activity to then detect anomalous behavior?
It's a very, very good question. It could be. It is going to be a very, very challenging task. Currently, our assumption is that organization would not allow to include hundreds of types of IoT devices, and are going to have a limited number of IoT devices inside the organization. And for a limited number of IoT devices, like we did a research about 25, 30 type of IoT devices, if you are assuming that in the initial stage they are not compromised, it is feasible after 2 weeks to have a more accurate normal behavior model for each IoT device. Of course, if the market will evolve, I would expect that maybe the manufacturers themselves will induce a model about what is the normal behavior of the IoT and provide that to the organizations to install inside their firewall, inside their intrusion detection system, to detect if the devices are compromised. But the point is actually correct.
Okay. I'm Alan Schlafer. I'm the chairman of the Wharton DC Innovation Summit. First, I got 2 related questions. One, to the extent that we're relying more on the cloud for software and everything else, is that increasing our vulnerability? And second question is, you frightened us all. with all that's going to happen to us, what can we do as individuals, business people, members of the faculty or whatever, to protect ourselves from the huge risks out there in the cyber war world?
First of all, about your first question, look, it's a very, very, very big dilemma. From one hand, the cloud, it's an amazing solution, especially in my opinion, for small businesses. I think that it would be great if small businesses that cannot afford to have a security specialist inside the organization will move to the cloud. Because the cloud, at least there is somebody that can afford to offer security services for these small businesses. Just to give you an example, we develop a very, very small and I won't call it stupid, but basic device to do a security analysis inside organizations. Because many small organizations cannot afford to have a security specialist. So we went to one of the biggest law firms in Israel, that has 150 lawyers. It's a very big law firm, at least in Israel. I think that even in the US, it's a big law firm. And this law firm works on merger and acquisition and of millions of dollars. You know, it's a very important law firm. The motivation to attack them is huge, definitely, because of the deals that they are doing. And we wanted to make a pilot with our small device that is doing automatic security analysis. Okay. So we sat with them. It was almost 2:00. And he said, the IT guy said that he has to leave. So we asked him, why you need to leave? It's only 2:00. He said, no, I need to meet a couple. Why you need to meet a couple at 2 p.m.? After another few minutes of discussion, we discovered that actually his real work is a DJ in weddings. Now, why I gave you this example? A law firm. The data in this company is so important. Huge security risks. And their IT guy is the DJ in weddings.
Maybe he was responsible also for the law firm in Panama.
Yes. It would be much better for this company to have all the IT infrastructure in the cloud. At least somebody is taking care for it. Of course, the risk is that the single point of failure, if somebody managed to understand how to attack the cloud, then the damage is huge. But for this law firm, it's better not to have any computer managed by this IT guy. That's for sure. In my opinion, is to follow the announcement of new products. There are many, many companies developing new innovative products. Usually the traditional products are not that good. So to follow the most innovative product and install them, and to follow the instructions of the experts or the recommendation of the experts. That's my opinion. Okay.